Madame Biss.
Good afternoon, and thank you so much for the opportunity to address this committee. My name is Michèle Biss, and I'm the Policy Director and Human Rights Lawyer at Canada Without Poverty. For those who are not aware of our organization, Canada Without Poverty is a nonpartisan, not-for-profit, and charitable organization dedicated to ending poverty in Canada. For nearly 50 years, CWP has been championing the human rights of people living in poverty, and since our inception, our board of directors has been comprised entirely of persons with lived experience of poverty. I will begin at the outset by noting for the record that though we're not discussing this section of the BIA at this meeting, Canada Without Poverty is very much in support of the amendments that were tabled last week with regard to the National Housing Strategy legislation. But of course, this afternoon, my comments will focus specifically on the Poverty Reduction Act within Division 20 of Part 4 of the Budget Implementation Act. This legislation comes at a critical moment in Canada's history. This is the legislation that will guide all laws, policies, and programs for millions in Canada who make daily decisions about whether to pay their hydro bills or put food on the table. And it is so important that we get this right. While Canada Without Poverty supports Canada's first poverty reduction strategy and that it be secured in legislation, we do have serious concerns as to whether this section truly adheres to and implements Canada's international human rights obligations. As this committee is no doubt aware, after decades of advocacy, the Poverty Reduction Act was tabled in November 2018 by the Honourable Minister Jean-Yves Duclos. In response to the legislation, along with our partners at Citizens for Public Justice, who are also here at this meeting today, and Campaign 2000, we coordinated an open letter with recommendations to this legislation. It is very important for this committee to know that despite the fact that this open letter was signed by over 500 organizations and individuals, including the Canadian Council of Churches, Acorn Canada, Oxfam Canada, and the Canadian Women's Foundation, none of these amendments were reflected when the bill was lifted word for word into the Budget Implementation Act. I urge the members of this committee to seriously consider the recommendations that we have brought forward on this critical legislation by Canada Without Poverty, Citizens for Public Justice, and hundreds of other stakeholders across the country. In particular, we recommend that the legislation be amended to place Canada as a leading country in the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals by committing to the spirit of SDG 1, which is to end poverty. In its current form, as has been mentioned by a number of senators in the last meeting, the goal of the legislation is to reduce poverty by 50% by 2030. But the reality is that when we only commit to reducing poverty, we create opportunity for some and not all, especially those who are the most marginalized. I want to take a moment to reflect on the importance of today. Today, we saw the release of the report of the inquiry on missing and murdered Indigenous women. In that report, they noted the significant intergenerational discrimination and marginalization of poverty for Indigenous women and girls. Now, more than ever, is a moment to ensure that no one is left behind and that the most marginalized are taken into account. And this can only be done if we commit within our poverty reduction strategy and legislation to end poverty. The legislation and accompanying regulations must also recognize the limits of the methodology behind Canada's new official poverty line, the market basket measure. This new poverty line, whether we like it or not, will be used to establish eligibility for programs, and that means that it carries significant weight. And though civil society has raised many concerns about the methodology behind the MBM, Statistics Canada and ESDC have still not released a What We Heard report. Statistics Canada must be mandated to understand that it too has a role in implementing our human rights obligations to ensure an accurate methodology. Thirdly, we ask that the legislation and accompanying regulations ensure that the National Advisory Council on Poverty can adequately implement the progressive realization of economic and social rights. So concretely, this means that the council must be mandated as independent, given authority to make recommendations, and require remedial action for compliance for the rights of people in poverty, and a sufficient budget to fulfill its mandate. Four, and as has been noted by senators in the last meeting, we strongly recommend that this committee put forward an amendment for Section 11, which arbitrarily authorizes the dissolution of the council once poverty has been reduced by 50% of the 2015 MBM levels. As has been noted by civil society, this is highly problematic and demonstrates a complete disregard for the other 50% of people living in poverty, often the most marginalized. It is also an excellent example of why Canada must not merely strive to reduce poverty, but instead dedicate ourselves to ending it. And lastly, we recommend that the government commit to working in partnership with Indigenous governments to co-develop initiatives to ensure accountability and implementation of remedies for the distinctive barriers faced by First Nations, Métis, and Inuit persons living in poverty. I look forward to answering questions in this regard. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup.